on Live from Seattle, we're talking about what's next for the next generation and you. And Dr. Tracey Wilen is with us. We're going to be talking about some of the impact of technology and change on our society and some of the big mistakes new graduates and you may be making as you're looking for a new job or filling out a resume. Dr. Wilen, thanks for joining us.
Oh, thanks for having me, Michelle. I really appreciate it.
So help me out here. As we're going into a new economy and things seem to be changing all the time, I just want to get right to it. What mistakes am I making as I'm going out looking for a job, especially on my resume?
Well, one of the things that a lot of people do, both students and adults, is that you're assuming that finding a job is like it is in the past. But today, job descriptions are much more specialized. They're looking, the whole process is different. We're in a digital world. And the biggest mistake a lot of people do is just spam generic resumes to every job that they can find in a job board without reading the job requirements, without considering what experience and skills that they have that are appropriate for the job they're applying for. So I think that's the big one that's still happening today.
So we'd be better off if we really want that job to really understand what is it they're looking for and what are my skills that I can fine-tune on my resume to say, look, I meet your needs.
That's right. Every resume should be custom, and you should be looking at jobs, looking at the requirements. And if you don't need about 80% of them, which is usually at the bottom of the job description, you need to learn to let it go. Because spamming, you know, today there's software, there's applicant tracking systems. So your resume could be going into a black hole inappropriately because you're just not applying for the right jobs. A lot of people assume that resumes get them jobs, but they really don't. They get them interviews. And you have one page of valuable real estate to attract an employer to show that you are a highly qualified person for that job opening.
Wow, that is really well said. Good for you. That is a really good way to say it and a big reminder. It's like one of those things when you listen to a radio show, there's maybe a phrase that you just don't want to forget, and that's it. Resumes do not get you jobs. They get you interviews. It's like they're like what knocks on the door and gets them to open it, but that's not what's going to get you invited in.
That's right. And so if you think of it in that way, the resume has to be a very tight one-page story that has chock full of metrics and appropriate data about yourself. You can take the interview if you get to that point, and that's where you can really expand about a lot of other things. But really what you want to do is hit the mark with the job that you're applying to so that you get selected over the hundreds of other people who are also very highly qualified for that job. You want to be able to get their attention, get pulled out for that interview.
Another thing that I think that we can get wrong on resumes, and correct me if I'm wrong, as we're looking in this new economy and towards tomorrow, some things never change. We like to pad our resumes, and people do that. How can I say, I'll give you an example, Tracey, I'll see what you think of this. This isn't so much line as it is padding. My son had been a window washer since age 15. It was his part-time job, and it became his full-time job. And he would say, instead of saying on his resume, I washed windows, he would say, I am a silica-based optical partition clarification specialist. That's padding a little bit, right?
Well, no, he's a smart guy, because what he's doing is he's translating his job that he's doing into a language, an industry language, that someone in the industry would understand.
I hope so. I thought that was pretty clever, but yeah. I think it speaks to something bigger. That was very honest. That's what he does. But there are people who pad their resume and aren't quite as honest about what they do, and that's never a good idea, is it?
No, I mean, you think you have to be accurate because everything will be checked. You know, in a digital world, everyone is Googled, everyone will have background checks, you will have reference checks, people will check your credentials, the industry, your years, your education, your college. So you have to remember that you can't fudge anything anymore. But to his point, because he uses industry language, that's part one. Part two is the metric. What did he accomplish over the 10 years as this excellent window washer? Was he number one in his field? Did he open up new channels for the business? Did he morph that into his own company, showing me that he's an entrepreneur and he's a startup person? All of these things are very attractive to me as a hiring manager. So I say kudos to him, but I want to hear the rest of the story.
And
I think a lot of people don't tell the rest of the story.
What is encouraging about what you're saying is that if you have any experience at all, you have experience. Pull off of that experience. Sometimes we can feel overwhelmed because there are a huge amount of candidates at a job, but you are a unique person. You have your own unique abilities and experiences to bring to the job. All you are saying, Dr. Tracey Wilen, who is with us, and you can go to TraceyWilen.com for more information. All you're saying as a former Silicon Valley executive, someone who's been in leadership, you've worked with Apple, HP, Cisco Systems, Apollo Groups, you know, you have this experience. So all you're saying to the person who's trying to get their foot in the door is, tell me more. I want the whole story. The truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Exactly. You know, I'll just give you a simple example. I met a young woman, and she wanted to apply for a job to be an event planner, and she didn't think that she had anything on her in her background because she was a student. But as we talked about it, I found out she was the social chairman for her dorm, and she planned a lot of college parties and events with success, and she grew that throughout the campus. She also ended up planning her neighbor's corporate party of over 500 people, from everything, from the DJ to the caterers to the band. And then number three is she planned her friend's wedding. And so she did everything from suits to nuts. So what she did is she explained to me, in terms that I could understand in industry, that she would be a dynamite event planner because she was already doing it and taking initiative. And on top of that, as we talked about her major, which was in marketing, her minor was in hospitality. These are all things that I want to hear about if you're positioning for an event planning job, because you're doing exactly what you're going to be doing in the workforce, but you're doing it on your own initiative.
That's powerful. And what I'm learning from you for perhaps the next generation is that they may have a lot of experience with social media and being able to utilize that social media, but it never does replace that personal touch of who you are intimately, who you are, what you've done, and being able to connect with whatever generation they may be applying to, whatever company they may be applying to as well. Dr. Tracey Wilen, what a great guest you are. Very fun talking with you. You can go to www.traceywilen.com to find out more information. She's the author of many, many books and a delightful guest. Thank you.
Oh, well, thank you.